Good evening, Swamiji's and Brahmacharis of Ramakrishna Math, guests, professors and faculty, and students of IIT Madras. Now let us begin our orientation by having a look at some of the soul-stirring statements of Swami Vivekananda. Arise, awake, and stop not till the goal is reached. Never think there is anything impossible for the soul. It is the greatest heresy to think so. If there is sin, this is the only sin, to say that you are weak or others are weak. We are what our thoughts have made us, so take care about what you think. Words are secondary, thoughts live, they travel far. This life is short, the vanities of the world are transient, but they alone live who live for others, the rest are more dead than alive. Swami Vivekananda was the embodiment of love, manifestation of divinity, and an expression of great strength. Vivekananda's philosophy was not one of weakness and superstition, but one that brings strength, courage, and truth to the one who applies them. All ideals that VSC stands for are vividly visible in the character and ideas of Swami Vivekananda. Now let me present you the vision and ideals of VSC. The vision of VSC is threefold: to present the youth the greatness and profoundness of India and its cultural heritage, and to rejuvenate and kindle the national spirit in the Indian citizen; to present the rationality behind the Indian philosophy and its customs and beliefs; and to prevent the values and to present the values of the Indian custom in their true light; to put before youth the presence of a higher and profounder life by which he may be both an invaluable citizen and also a complete person in himself. Now let me explain the birth of VSC. In 1997, a group of inquisitive and enthusiastic IITians felt the need for a students' forum that could expand one's horizons and experience the perennial philosophy of India's cultural heritage. The result of their initiative is an ever-expanding and evolving organization powered by the cooperation of enthusiastic faculty and students of this institution. Now you may ask me, why choose Swami Vivekananda for such a mission and mission? So let us take a look at some of the comments of eminent personalities on Swami Vivekananda. Rabindranath Tagore told, "If you want to know India, study Vivekananda." Mahatma Gandhi remarked, "I have gone through his works very thoroughly, and after having gone through them, the love that I had for my country became a thousandfold." Christopher Isherwood said, one of the very greatest historical figures that India has ever produced." Subhash Chandra Bose exclaimed, if he had been alive, I would have been at his feet." So I think there is no more need to establish the intensity of inspiration he radiates. The one motto on which VSC runs is this: unselfishness is God. I can confidently say that you can clearly see the manifestation of this very ideal in all the volunteers of VSC, and the same is expected from ones who wish to join. Now let us have a look at some of our activities. Friday discussions. The Friday discussions are the platform where the volunteers of VSC discuss, debate, and digest various ideas of Swami Vivekananda and several other luminaries. These discussions are held in the VSC room, which is situated in the Brahmaputra hostel. Sunday classes. Sunday classes are the most cherished activity of VSC. Discourses will be on topics related to national heritage, personality development, and character building. These classes will be generally presided over by Swami Atmashadhananji Maharaj, who has also been our mentor for the past 10 years. Sunday classes consist of chanting of Shanti Mantras, guided meditation session, reading from the letters of Swami Vivekananda, a 40 to 45 minute talk on the day's topic, question and answer session. Special lectures. Our special lecture series is where we invite esteemed speakers to speak on varied topics ranging from Indian culture to deeper meaning of spirituality to varied aspects of human mind and others. Over the years, we have had many esteemed speakers deliver lectures. You can see some of them here. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam spoke on creativity and youth power. Professor TGK Murthy, who is a former ISRO director, spoke on Swami Vivekananda, an intuitive scientist. Michael Danino, who is the convener of the International Forum for India's Heritage, spoke on why be proud to be an Indian, 12 great achievements of the Indian civilizations. Shraddhalu Ranade, who is a scientist, spoke on the Indian genius. Vivekananda Heritage Walk. Chennai occupies a special position in Swamiji's life. He delivered 7 profound lectures on his way back from the Parliament of Religions, Chicago, after having a triumphant success there. To acquaint freshers with the rich heritage of Chennai, we have been organizing Vivekananda Heritage Walk, connecting some of the heritage sites that are closely associated with Swami Vivekananda. Calendar distribution. Every year, calendars are distributed to all the freshers as a welcome to IIT. National Youth Day celebrations. Swami Vivekananda's birthday, which is on 12th January, is celebrated as National Youth Day every year. As part of the celebrations, we organize a special lecture, an exhibition on Swamiji's teachings, and sale of books on personality development, concentration, meditation, and other related subjects. And we can see an excerpt from the past here. Library. VSC has a rich collection of books which were collected over many years. There are about 700 books covering various topics like personality development, biographies, Indian history and heritage, spirituality, scriptures, and philosophical works. All are welcome to join our activities. There is neither any fee charge nor any membership required to attend our events and activities. Thank you. Om Tat Sat.
Now, I request the guests of the evening to grace the dais. I request our volunteer Vamshiji to present a fruit basket to Sri NS Narayan Swami sir. I request our volunteer Ashishji to present a fruit basket to Sri Vinayak Lohani. I request our volunteer Bharadwaji to present a fruit basket to Swami Atmashraddhananda Maharaj. Now, I take the privilege of introducing Swami Atmashraddhananda Maharaj, who has been the supporting pillar and guiding light of VSC for the past 10 years. He currently edits Vedant Kesari, a cultural and health spiritual monthly, which is in its 100th year of publication. He has authored and edited few books in English, which include Bhagavad Gita for students, Upanishads for students, universal prayers for youth, Indian culture, its ageless charm and timeless appeal, Vivekananda tells stories and few others. He has addressed various groups consisting of students, teachers and others in places such as Pune, Nagpur, Bangalore, Mysore, Mumbai, Jammu, Vadodara, Chandigarh, Kolkata and Delhi. He has been delivering talks in our Sunday classes for the past 10 years. His continued guidance and association with VSC has been our vital strength. Now, without making any further delay, I request Swami Atmashraddhananda Maharaj to deliver the welcome address.
Dear Vinayak Lohani, Sri Narayan Swami, esteemed faculty members, invited guests, revered Swami Satyagyananji and other monastic brothers in the audience, and my very dear young friends, both freshers as well as the older ones. Namaskars, and on behalf of Vivekananda Study Circle, I extend a warm welcome to everyone to our 18th annual inaugural function. On behalf of all the volunteers, past, present, and of course future, on behalf of everyone who has been helping us in many ways in all these years, I extend a warm and cordial welcome to this annual event, which marks the beginning of our activities for the academic year 2014 and 15. We have gathered here to be part of yet another year of activities centering around the life-giving, man-making, character-building message of Swami Vivekananda, which has inspired millions of people the world over. Just recently was concluded the 150th birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda, which is observed in all parts of the world, all parts of India. And we at IIT, at VSC too, had our share, our great privilege of organizing activities and events in that context. It's a delight to welcome all present here, most of whom are young, intelligent, and noble, the finest of our youth in India. To be young is a privilege. It's a privilege to be young and to dream of a great life, a life of success, of recognition, of contribution to the society, of joy and fulfillment. The Taittiriya Upanishad speaks of a young man, yuva syat sadhu yuva adhyayakaha ashishto dradishta balishtaha. A young man, noble and learned, strong in every way, physically, intellectually, morally, such a man is fit to pursue life in a meaningful way. Energy and enthusiasm are the hallmark of youth, along with freshness of a youthful body and mind. Such a youth is indeed a privileged section of the society. But being young itself is not sufficient. One should also be rightly directed. It is not sufficient to work hard, but it is also important in which direction is our hard work directed or is going to. Youth is a golden period of life, no doubt. But then unless it is well utilized, well directed, it can also become a dark phase of life. Essentially, the youth energy is like a mass of energy. It has to be channeled. Like a dam across a river, we have to channel it. Water in itself looks just like any other liquid matter. But when millions of gallons of water rush through a river unchecked, it can cause widespread devastation. It may look simple, but water has tremendous energy. As you know, it is the potential energy which becomes kinetic energy and does all the wonder, good or bad. Recently, I had the occasion to visit Sardar Sarovar Dam across Narmada River near Vadodara in Gujarat. You know, it's a massive river valley project, one of the largest in Asia. What an inspiring place it was. Next to the dam is located the hydro power generation unit. There are large turbines there which rotate through the power of flowing waters and produce so many megawatts of electricity, which is supplied to hundreds of towns and villages across three states in India. This electricity generation is a fine example of how human energies can be or should be channeled. Swami Vivekananda said, no power can be created, but it can be directed. Human beings have tremendous power, and in youth, this power is at its peak, at its best. We must tame it, check it, and channel it in truly fruitful and productive channels, and that would produce the power of goodness and love, which will light up our lives and lives of others. Swami Vivekananda spoke of renunciation and service as the national ideals of India. What does that mean? Swamiji explained renunciation in the following way. He said, renounce the lower so that you may get the higher. What is the foundation of society? Morality, ethics, laws. Renounce. Renounce all temptation to take your neighbor's property, to put hands upon your neighbor, all the pleasure of tyrannizing over the weak, all the pleasure of cheating others by telling lies. Is not morality the foundation of society? He further said, sacrifice, give up, not for zero, not for nothing, but to get the higher. But who can do this? You cannot until you have got the higher. You may talk, you may struggle, you may try to do many things, but renunciation comes by itself when you have got the higher. Then the lesser will fall away by itself. This is practical religion. So giving up the lower for the higher, that is renunciation. Not running away from the society, but by contributing to society through giving up our self-centeredness and living a life devoted to a higher ideal of living. The motto of Vivekananda Study Circle, as Sai Tej has also pointed out, is nation building through character building. In other words, if you want to build nation, build and prepare individuals with noble character. Nation does not mean only improving our infrastructure to have more materialistic progress. This is necessary, needed, but what is more needed is the molding of right kind of human beings. This is the need of a nation, an organization, of a company, of a school or a college or a house. In fact, every department of life. What we need is the right kind of human beings. We should focus on man-making, which is what will lead to right type of nation-making or nation-building. Character-building means building up our lives, our personalities, our behavior, our priorities in life, everything on the twin principles of self-control and unselfishness. For this, one should take care of what one thinks, what one feels, what one sees and hears, or likes to see and hear. In the famous Vedic prayer, one says, may we hear what is auspicious, and may we hear what is auspicious. We must be on our guard. Character is built little by little, by our thoughts, by our actions in day-to-day life. You may recall the part of the quotation which is put on the calendar, which is distributed to all the people this time, all the freshers and the newcomers this time. The full passage of that quote is this. Swamiji says, this is a quotation from Swamiji. He says, if you want to judge of the character of a man, look not at his great performances. Every fool may become a hero at one time or another. Watch a man do his most common actions. Those are indeed the things which will tell you the real character of a great man. Great occasions rouse the lowest of human beings to some kind of greatness, but he alone is the really great man whose character is great always, the same wherever he may be. So let us begin by changing ourselves, and then can we have the right to change others. Let us remember this very important fact. Now, service. Swami said there are two national ideals of India. One is renunciation and there is service. Service is an outcome of character. The sum total of all character or goodness lies in our willingness to do some good to others. Swami Vivekananda rightly said, in the world, take always the position of the giver. Give everything and look for no return. Give love, give help, give service, Give any little thing you can, but keep out the barter. Make no conditions and none will be imposed. To sum up, sacrificing the lower for the higher and giving to others out of goodness of heart is what constitutes the true meaning of channeling youth power. This channeling may assume many forms and names. Vinayak Lohani, who is going to shortly address us, is one such example of youth energy well channeled. Well, academic studies are important, entertainment is important, ambition is important, and many more things are important. But what is most important is man making, developing oneself, developing one's intellectual and moral potential, and finding a true meaning in life. This is the need of the hour, the need of the country, the need of the family, the need of the individual. VSC has been committed to this ideal, and that we have been receiving a continued support from the IIT community for the past 18 years is a testimony to this noble fact. We welcome Sri Lohani, who has come all the way from Calcutta to address us, to Professor Narayan Swami, who has kindly agreed to say a few words representing the IIT faculty, and to all our invited guests and to every student present here, we extend once again a warm and cordial welcome. Please come and join us in all our activities with enthusiasm. Namaskar.
Thank you, Maharaji, for the enlightening message. Now, I request our faculty guest of the evening, Sri N.S. Narayan Swami, Associate Professor of Computer Science and Engineering Department, to address the audience.
So, namaskar, everyone. When I agreed to give the inaugural address, I had assumed that there would be Sri Vinayak Lohani, and I was already nervous at that time, given the kind of sacrifice that he had made in his life. But kind of I told myself that, well, he is probably the classmate of my brother at IIT Kharagpur. I can strike a rapport and I can manage to give a speech to this audience. There'll be a lot of young BTech students, and I've been a prof here for 12 years. And I said, okay, fine. And then I landed up here. I had written a short essay that I want to speak about. It takes approximately 3 minutes. Speaking for 10 minutes is beyond me. And that's why I'm trying all this stuff now. And then I came here and I saw very senior monks from the Ramakrishna mission. And then I see Professors Balaji, and then I see Professor Karmalkar, then the Dean of Students. And now my hands are shivering, my pulse is racing, and I have to manage for 3 minutes, right? So to hold your attention. And I'd also assumed that there are lots of undergraduate students here, and I suddenly see that there are undergraduate students from the past and there are very few undergraduate students here. But I will still manage to communicate this intense emotional rant that took me about half an hour to write, given the title of this evening's topic, which is service as a way of life. And I really look forward to the speech that is to be delivered by Sri Vinayak Lohani. And I've asked myself, what is service, and what are the prerequisites for service? And some thoughts that come to my mind are that the end result of an act of service is a feeling of relief for another fellow being, an increase in dignity, and the decreasing suffering of a fellow being. Of course, these acts ideally should not adversely affect another person. This, of course, is debatable, because we all know the story of Robin Hood, who stole from the rich and gave it to the poor. Leaving that aside, in an ideal world, if all of us engage and indulge in service, then our life and the world that we live in could probably be called utopia. As scientists and engineers, budding scientists and budding engineers, and thinkers and philosophers of the humanities, what kind of service should we contemplate? And this is what this short essay of mine is about. And it is a bit intense, and there is a lot of finger pointing, but I hope it does not hurt anyone. The list of services that one or each one of us could indulge in is endless, and it's unenviably endless. And most of the thoughts that I have are relevant by and large to India. And in my opinion, the root of all these thoughts is that we are at our society faces an identity crisis. And from a joint family setting about three generations back, we are now a country of atomic families. And if you look at the aspirations of an atomic family, what we see is that a family of 3 to 4, we have a washing machine, a refrigerator, a mixer grinder, a gas connection with 2 cylinders, a minimum of 10 electronic devices. I kind of went around my house counting. There are a minimum of 10 electronic devices for entertainment and communication, at least one motorized vehicle. This is the baseline quality of life for most of us here. And when we move away from our homes to academic institutions like IITs, we assume that these will be provided for us. We aspire for these in our lives. We need air-conditioned facilities, like in this room, to have intellectual thoughts. We need clean toilets. Rather, we want clean toilets. We want traffic-free roads. We want a hassle-free life. And all these we want. Then, in front of whose house do we build our factories? Where would the effluents go? Where would the exhaust go? Maybe we can ship it all off to a poor country that can reclaim some useful stuff from all the things that we refuse after using them. Is there a global kabadiwala? Is there a global kupaikaran? I don't know, I can't translate it in other languages. Somebody who takes away or recycles a lot of waste. Is there some third world country which is poor enough to recycle the waste that we generate? Like India? I'm sorry, we are India. This is a thought. Then there is the other side that I face every day. There are people who clean our toilets, who sweep our streets, they guard our gardens. Many of them come from a part of this country. I will just name one, Assam. And why do they come here? They come here because of the exchange rate, which means less money for more labor in Chennai means more money in Assam. To get an identity card for these people who come from far away in this city is extremely hard. That's a society that we live in. And if you don't believe me, please ask the security guards that you see on this campus. Then this morning I look around and I see that there is a lady who collects the garbage from my house and from all our houses every morning. She walks up 2 stories in 50 quarters, in 50 buildings, and she's probably about 50 years old, and she limps all the way to a tricycle and takes the garbage that we generate. And here I have a low technology solution to all of us here, and I assume they would be students. I apologize for this advice to all the seniors here. Please go down 2 floors instead of a poor lady walking up 2 floors in 50 buildings. If you can't, if you're old, please send your 8-year-old child to do this. And if you're an undergraduate student, please take it down. The child learns an unteachable lesson from the smell of rotting garbage, the value of effort and humility. Mahatma Gandhi cleaned his toilets. I was a warden of a hostel here. I also studied in a similar institution, lived in similar hostels. Our students dirty the toilets and leave them dirty. They blame the monkeys for the dirty clothes that hung from their corridors. And on hostel nights, they generated so much garbage. It was because of their generosity, they said. What kind of generosity? They paid the cleaners 500 rupees the next morning to clean up all the garbage that they generated the previous night. Like I said, the list is endless. And it's an endless business of finger pointing. So where do we start? Can we not start being useful? Can we not start being of service? What is the prerequisite? How was Bapu able to clean his toilet? It's simply because he did not ignore his deed. Right? Of course, the deed was going to the toilet. He owned up. It was his responsibility. But then others used the toilet too. Right? That's why he was different. That's why he was a Mahatma. He was ready to stand up for other people's deeds too. And he was selfless. Right? He could share his toilet. Yes, definitely, this is a question that many people ask, that can I share something so personal? Yes, you can. Right? Privacy is not so important. He probably gave everybody the privacy that they deserved, so it was very easy for him to share something that we probably deem very private and personal. I can go on and on, I can become unpopular, like I have done in the past. I'll stop with, have a heart, be selfless, take responsibility, share. Then, I believe there will be peace and quiet and life. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Before inviting our chief guest, we have a small video.
Abilities and wealth accumulation. But then there are others who are taking the road less traveled and rewriting what success truly means. Hello, Maranodaya Mukherjee, and welcome to the third edition of Young Indian Leaders, an initiative which celebrates the power and spirit of India's youth and recognizes those young Indians who are leading by example. In today's episode, we will showcase four such young achievers who've become leaders not just by their actions, but by their beliefs and their attitudes. Our next story is about Vinayak Lohani, an IIT and IIM graduate who opted out of a career-defining placement process. Instead, he chose to start Parivaar, an organization for hundreds of destitute and homeless children. Let's take a look at how he managed to make a difference to the lives of these children.
Smiling children, happy children, children who remind you of your innocent past. However, it's the past these children want to forget. A past fraught with fear and uncertainty. Millions of children in India are without a home, without a family, and are left to fend for themselves on the streets.
But for at least 705 of them, there is Parivaar, a home for underprivileged children built in 2003 by Vinayak Lohani, an IIT-IIM graduate.
I voluntarily opted out of the placement process at IIM, which is a very important part and which happens towards the end of the two-year program.
So, at that time actually I wanted to do grassroots social work and I wanted to build an organization from scratch.
I used to cross two campuses in Kolkata. The boys and girls at Parivaar come from different underprivileged backgrounds.
So my starting dreams at that time were children, say girl children who were vulnerable to trafficking to prostitution, or children without any say home or family support, like children living in and around religious platforms, etc.
From the day the child steps to the threshold of Parivaar, their welfare becomes the sole responsibility of the organization till the time the child attains adulthood. Once under their tutelage, the organization provides them with almost all the facilities that a child deserves. Residential facilities, a formal school where they study English.
So I have a glance. So what do you think?
To learn computers besides other subjects. The school also has a well-equipped library and provides medical facilities to the children. The pampering has allowed these children to dream.
मैं चाहता हूँ टीचर बनके मैं से बिना पैसे में पढ़ाना चाहता हूँ।
मैं नर्स बनना चाहती हूँ क्योंकि मैं लोगों को सेवा करना चाहती हूँ। मैं आगे जाके टीचर बनना चाहती हूँ इसलिए मुझे बच्चे पढ़ाना बहुत अच्छा लगता है।
Inspired by Vivekananda's teachings, giving up the cushy trappings of a corporate life 10 years ago was not a difficult choice for Vinayak. And Vinayak knew very early that if he had to inspire other people to identify with his ideals, he would have to take a leadership role.
Any such organization which is based on one thing, this inspirational quotient basically, their leadership assumes a very very important role.
बिना देख वही leader है, उनके पास रहने से, उनके प्रभाव से आप खुद को change कर सकते हैं। तो ऐसे leader है, वो सबको अनुप्राणित कर सकते हैं, सबके ऊपर, सबके मन के ऊपर, उनका जो प्रभाव है विस्तार कर सकते हैं।
These ideals reflect in what Parivaar has set out to achieve. For the children under their tutelage, the past ceases to exist. The present is being nurtured, and the future is full of endless opportunities.
To add to the information given in the video, Sri Vinayak Lohani ji has received many honors and awards for his tremendous service through Parivaar. Some of them are Nation Award for Child Welfare 2011, presented by our Honorary President of India. Sanskriti Award 2011, Country's Premier Award for Young Achievers, from our former President of India, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. IIM Calcutta's Distinguished Alumnus Award in 2011. IIT Kharagpur's Distinguished Alumnus Award in 2014. Has been inducted into India's Ministry of Women and Child Development's Working Group. Has addressed various communities all over the world. He has been the youngest to get the kind of awards he has got. Swami Vivekananda said, "This life is short. The vanities of the world are transient. But they alone live who live for others. The rest are more dead than alive." Now, without making any further delay, I request our chief guest, Sri Vinayak Lohani ji, to address this.
Revered monks of the Ramakrishna order, respected faculty who are present here, and other friends, students who have come here to attend this special program, I think the annual inaugural program of the Vivekananda Study Circle. A very good evening to you all. I think there is an allotted time of around 1 hour 10 minutes, out of which around 20 minutes are reserved for some interactive question and answers. So before that, I'll just speak. It may be shorter than that time so that we can have more time for some questions and answers. So friends, the theme of the talk which was suggested to me was service as a way of life. Now, speaking on a forum which is named after Swami Vivekananda, the first feeling which any speaker is bound to get is that one can never be fully up to the theme, up to the occasion, because you know the occasion and the forum, the platform is carrying the name of Swami Vivekananda. So however hard one may try, one may never do complete justice to this particular huge task of speaking on service as a theme and speaking in a forum which is named after Swami Vivekananda. But yeah, given this opportunity, I would like to share on basis of my own experience of say last 11 years or so in building up of my own work. So I'll be speaking strictly by my own experiences, and these should be taken some common learnings which I feel may be useful for all others, for young people in particular. Those I would like to highlight a few such ideas, but they should be still interpreted as say the understanding of one individual based on his limited experience. So friends, I'll just talk briefly about my background. I was born and had my school education in Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh. My father was in the government service in Madhya Pradesh. And thereafter I went to IIT Kharagpur to do B.Tech. Why did I go there? If this is a question like coming in minds of people, or some people ask me, it's just that, you know, just like in our society, particularly in say kind of middle class which puts a lot of premium on say education and careers emerging out of academic achievement, so it was like kind of a default option. Very often society presents options to us rather than we making those choices. Though we think, and sometimes I believe even fool ourselves in thinking that we are deciding, but it's actually the norms that the society has placed before us. So in this manner, just like, you know, I mean, a student at high school who was, say, good at, say, maths and sciences, taking up, say, mathematics at class 11 level when one had to choose one stream, and then appearing for engineering entrance examination and IIT JEE being the preeminent among such entrance tests, and then managing to qualify and getting into a B.Tech course. And then at the end of the 4 years, again, the society placing norms before you, the default options. So sitting through a placement process and then, say, getting a job. So I, just like anyone else, I went through all these. And from IIT, I went into Infosys as a, you know, software job, software engineer. So for 1 year, I was at Infosys in Bangalore. Now, during that time, I think I just saw a bit of a corporate environment also. So before that, I didn't have any idea. So it was an enjoyable period actually there. So I also, you know, looked at some people like, say, Mr. Murthy, Mr. N.R. Narayan Murthy, as say, an iconic inspirational figure, etc. So it was a good period, but I just wanted to explore other things and wanted to finally decide what I want to do for whole of my life. So I think in a bid to get that space for myself in which I could explore and finally decide, that I, with this purpose, I appeared in the, you know, the CAT for IIMs, the common admission test, which is there, and then I got admissions in, you know, IIMs, IIM Bangalore, Calcutta. I felt like going to Calcutta, so I joined there. Now, after coming to IIM Calcutta, within a month or so, I remember that I somehow got disenchanted with where this career will lead me to, because I had some exposure. I'd already got a work of having a job, so that, you know, sometimes a taste of achievement drives us. So a few of those achievements I tasted in my own humble way, say some successfully cracking some, say, competitive exams, say IIT JEE, or I had appeared at GRE also and got a decent score there and was getting scholarships in US university, and then, say, getting into IIM. So all these things were, all those achievements were, to some extent, you could say, quenched and satisfied. But one cannot go just like that for whole of one's life. Now, I seriously wanted to decide what exactly I want to do. Because after 1 or 2 months, then there used to be, say, pre-placement talks for summer placements and these kind of things. Lots of companies used to come there. So I think that was a very important period for me, because when I had a look at the people who were coming for these, say, corporate interactions, pre-placement talks, etc., who had experience of, say, 10 years, 15 years, or sometimes much more, then I, in my mind, I just sometimes got the feeling that I don't want to be in that position, say, after, say, 10, 15, or X number of years. So, when I in hindsight, with the advantage of hindsight, if I now try to analyze it, I think that what really inspired me was basically working or building or creating or leading based on something which can be called moral authority, which can be called leadership by certain personal force, leadership by some character force, as against, say, leadership or power which comes through certain position posts. So power or prestige coming through the certain position which you have in any organization, you are, because of your designation, because of your position, that somehow didn't attract me. I was fascinated by people who have actually led or influenced others based on this X factor. It's an X factor, because so it's very difficult to say from where it's coming, but it was certain to me that it is coming from within that individual, certain power within that individual. The professor discussed here about Mahatma Gandhi, So how he could create one of the largest movements during the freedom movement, and how millions followed him? What was the special power which was coming out of? Or say in post-independent India, there are figures. It could be famous figures, it could be not so famous figures. But examples are aplenty about on people who are leading by personal example, creating something. We had, say, Vinoba, for example, who had the world's largest land gift movement, Bhutan. How Vinoba one day in an Andhra village, he just thought that he'll appeal to the rich landlords of giving away their surplus land to the landless. So he just tried it, and some people accepted, and this motivated him to conduct that. He went on conducting it for 15 years, 13 years. He traveled on foot, mainly on foot, throughout the length and breadth of the country. And you know, I mean, how many millions of acres of land were gifted away during Bhutan. So what was that special force which was coming through this individual, which could move other people? This was something remarkable. I actually like wanted to have a taste of that, and I felt like developing that to whatever extent possible, having such kind of an ability to inspire people. So there were many examples. Baba Amte was an extraordinary example of a great humanitarian with his work in Maharashtra and with leprosy patients and people with disabilities. How he started in a barren land and created Anandvan, which was totally created by those people only whom society had discarded completely. So these kind of examples were there. So this, all this actually like inspired me to work in this direction, to actually build such abilities within myself, wherein I could develop my own personal life, inner life, and at the same time be of some use to the society. Now the greatest source of inspiration for all this, all these things, obviously in our modern times, has been Swami Vivekananda. One doesn't need to look beyond Swami Vivekananda. I feel he's an infinite fund of inspiration. Each line which Swami Vivekananda has ever uttered or ever written have a life transforming potential. I know people who had been inspired by a single line, by reading say a single line of Vivekananda. I know at least two people who have just seen a photograph of Swami Vivekananda and actually inspired to become even monastics in the Ramakrishna order. I personally know two, three such people. One was a brahmachari, Vivek Chaitanya from Australia, who had first seen the photograph of Swami Vivekananda in a Melbourne bookshop. He never knew of Vivekananda at that time, but the photograph conveyed to him that this man is an extraordinary man. He can't be anyone ordinary just by looking at his photograph. I know Swami Atmananda of the Raipur Ramakrishna Mission, who was the founder of Narayanpur, one of the biggest tribal welfare institutions of the mission. So he, as a 15 year old boy, when he was in class 9 or something, in a bookshop he saw, or somewhere on a calendar, Swami Vivekananda's photograph, and he just told himself that this man is a godlike man. I mean, he didn't know about whose photograph this is, etc. So lines of statements of Vivekananda, lines of Vivekananda, I even cited instances where looking even at photographs of Swami Vivekananda, people have fallen in love with Swami Vivekananda. And more you fall in love with Swami Vivekananda, more you will rise in your own spiritual life. So anyway, so this was basically my basic inspiration. So I wanted to also have you could say a congruence between the work I am doing and my own inner life. Because I thought that when I looked at these, the kind of work I can do, say, in a mainstream corporate career, I never had any disrespect for any work. I hugely respect, say, people who have, the names I mentioned, say, Narayan Murthy or many such people, small or big, famous or not so famous, who have like created large number of jobs or led the way or created a different image of India before the world. But thing was that I understood that certain competencies which are needed here, certain competencies are needed. I may or may not be having them. That's a different question. But certain competence which I thought I have, certain say values which I held dear, or certain capacity, say maybe capacity of, you know, going out of say a mainstream kind of a path, or so-called capacity to sacrifice, etc. So maybe like, or capacities of adjusting in different environments, capacities of dropping out of one's say default social class, etc. So I thought that I have these capacities. So but I thought that I can't, I mean the corporate sector, when I looked around, I didn't think that it can in the best possible way make use of these, you know, special capacities which I thought I had. Maybe like, I mean, whether I had or not is a different question, but I, in my own self-concept, I thought that these certain values I hold dear, certain abilities or capacities I have of a subtler, softer nature. These are not skills in the real sense, but certain abilities nonetheless. So I thought that I should do something which is completely in line with these abilities or capacities which I have, so that there is no alienation. In today's world, we see so much alienation between, say, what one wants to be from within and what one is doing. That alienation itself is a cause of tremendous dissatisfaction, and people are, you know, I mean, trying hard to get over that alienation. So anyway, in my case, I thought it should be not just in sync, but they should be directly related, in the sense that suppose if I strengthen my these abilities or strengthen my inner life, or to go by Swami Vivekananda's thesis, if I purify myself more and more, then I should choose a work which should become more and more successful as a result of I progressing in my inner life. So both of them should have a cause and effect kind of relationship. The more I progress, say, in my inner life, the more successful my external work should become. So I wanted to seek such a work. What I want to say is this. So in this way, I thought, I therefore decided to go by the method of elimination, I mean, to use the language of mathematics. So the things which I felt for sure, which I don't want to do. So I thought I'll start giving up on those things. So I realized that this corporate kind of, you know, I mean, upsetting for placements, I do not want to do. So I gave that, you know, I mean, I opted out of the placement voluntarily. After the first year, I signed a placement register of opting out. And therefore, I was a free person. In my year two, I was just managing to, you know, I mean, just barely attended classes and just managed to pass, etc., with the help of, you know, last night crashers which my friends helped me with. So because second year is more built around the placement process, so since I'd opted out of the placement, and one reason was that it exempted me from sitting through the pre-placement talks, and which were compulsory for everyone. So I told the placement office, I took a strange case before them, they had never heard of such an appeal. I said that since I'm not availing of any benefits of the placement office, since I have opted out of the placement, I should be exempted from, you know, going through what was, you know, at that time a torture for me to sit through almost daily a company giving a pre-placement talk. So my second year, I became very free, and I began to get more exposure for myself. I began to visit certain, say, social organizations, big or small NGOs. So I came in touch with certain NGOs which were working with children in Calcutta. I was in Calcutta only at that time. So anyway, during this time, I got some linkages got built with certain friends, particularly those who were doing PhD, a five-year program at IIM, who outstayed my own batch since they were for 2-3 years more. And I always believe they had a wider interest range than, say, the 2-year MBA students who were very narrowly focused on, you know, the corporate sector and only read what I call pink and orange colored papers. I mean, that is the business papers. So their intellectual interests were much wider of, say, the some of the PhD candidates. So they became my, you know, mean friends and sounding boards. We became sounding boards to each other, I can say. In this way, one or two professors also encouraged. So in this way, like, my stay at IIM finished. Now after that, I was, since I had opted out of placement, I was without any job. I took a small rented room. Its rent was 1,000 rupees a month. So you can well imagine what kind of room it would be. So such a room I took, and I began to take, say, whatever number of lectures I wanted to for the students appearing for CAT. Say, if, I mean, they used to pay me that I enrolled or I tied up with a coaching institute for MBA entrance. So whatever I needed, small sum for, you know, just bare maintenance at that time. So those many lectures only I took. It could be 8 lectures in a month, 8 2-hour lectures in a whole month, etc. So that left me a lot of time also, in which I was working out what I should be doing. I was still without any idea, and I had already, my batch had passed out. I lived in the hostel till the day the new batch was coming, and till the day I was asked to move out. So I, you know, tried to extend the stay as long as possible. After that, I moved to this rented room. And again, months were passing. I traveled to some NGOs here and there outside, I mean, in other parts of the country also, meeting certain social entrepreneurs or, say, founders of both organizations. I mean, in social sector, you have two kinds of people generally. One are, say, the activists, the other are institution builders. So meeting both kinds of people, I mean, say, leaders of social movements who are more like activists, and say institution builders who are not activists, but they are more like entrepreneurs. So this kind of exposure I was getting. Then months were passing, I still didn't know what to do, and I was like in a situation of some kind of despair, though I trusted myself always. But still, I mean, months and months were passing. So it was like this. When I used to go to IIM to meet those friends long after my batch had passed, even say security guard used to say that, how long will you hang around? So all these things, I increased my despair in some way. But then I thought, what can I do in social sector? At that time, I wrote some articles, 3-4 articles for the Outlook magazine, which had a one-page column called Making a Difference, which features certain social initiatives. So these kind of things I was doing. I also dabbled in some fiction writing, etc. So published on certain, you know, I mean, websites, etc. At that time, literary websites, certain short story, etc. So anyway, those kind of things. So, but what exactly I want to do in this, you know, social sphere, I wasn't clear of. Then I asked myself, what can I do? There are whole lot of things. I mean, one can work in, say, environment, in livelihoods, with say, farmers, rural development, so many different kinds of domains. I understood that lots of these things need a great know-how of that particular domain or a certain domain expertise. I didn't have any. And I was sure that I made up in my mind that I won't work anywhere, even in an NGO. So I won't take up a job. If whatever I do, it will be on my own. So it will be an entrepreneurial venture in some way, initiative in some way. So then I asked myself, what do I have? You know, any entrepreneurship, I think, starts with these three things. One is who you are, basically your own traits, inclinations. It's more the inner kind of ability set, which I mentioned. The second is what you have, which means these kind of competence. It could be your education, it could be your certain domain expertise, etc. Third, very interestingly, is who you have, your own network, associations, etc., which you can may possibly leverage, possibly take help from. So it starts in this way. And it's not, I actually like read a very interesting paper on entrepreneurship recently. And it actually contrasted, say, an entrepreneurial work with any other kind of work. Whereas any other kind of work is, goal driven. It has certain preset goals and you have certain resources including abilities, competency set and other hard financial resources, etc., whatever. And then using these resources to reach that goal. Whereas, that paper said that this is very causal. It said that it's a causal kind of a relationship. From resources, you try to reach that goal in the optimal kind of manner. Whereas entrepreneurship is just opposite of that. And I agree with this actually, with my own experience. It's that you don't have any preset goal in entrepreneurship. You just continuously keep viewing what you have, these resources, who you are, what you have and who you have, and then try to, it's very effectual, the various possible effects you see, what all effects it can have, and any of them, those effects can become a goal. So goals keep changing in an entrepreneurial journey. Some company may have started in some way, but it, on its course, it changed its way. There are so many instances, if you read about successful entrepreneurs, how they started, how certain opportunities came. They revised their goals. It wasn't that they were working towards one goal, a predefined, predetermined goal. But they kept on looking at their resources and, manipulated or worked through their resources, kept on increasing the resource set. And through that, whatever new goals emerge, they tried that. So in this way, I thought that what I have and I thought that since these domain expertise I do not have, the best I have is these, like the two key values, like I thought I hold dear, and it had some emotional resonance within me. It's of love and care, very simply speak, and these are universal values everyone else has. So I thought that let my work be such which manifests these two values, love and care. Now this is a very important point, because lots of entrepreneurial ventures start with an idea. So its motivation or its driving force is cerebral in nature. Whereas in my case, it was not cerebral in nature, because I didn't have any big idea. It didn't start from an idea. It started from certain sentiments, certain values. And the work that I wanted to do, in my view, I wanted to be an outcome or a epitome or manifestation of those particular values or sentiment, love and care, very simply. So I thought of this very simple thing that most basic example of, say, love and care, just like how in a family we live together. And so I thought of bringing up children who do not have anyone, and just like, say, at that time I was very young, I was around 25 or so. So I thought more in terms of elder sibling. Today I'll say as a parent or father, but at that time I thought that bringing up children as an elder brother. So that was the spirit. I thought, let me start a home. So this was the beginning. Home for children who do not have anyone, most destitute, say, orphan children who have lost both their parents, or or living mother is there in extreme poverty, who has either lost her husband or the husband has deserted, abandoned. Children have become homeless, living on railway platforms or on the roadside under, these plastic covers, etc. So such kind of conditions. Girl children from highly vulnerable areas, vulnerable to being trafficked into flesh trade, into all other forms of victimization, exploitation. So I had this kind of certain exposure and linkages I'd already built during my year two at IIM while I was engaging with NGOs. So here who you have actually came to my help, because that some kind of network I had stuck. And in this way, this was the thing. I later expanded to very impoverished tribal areas in Jharkhand and West Bengal. That came much later, 4 or 5 years after my beginning, because it needed an organization muscle to create a extensive field network across, say, number of villages in these Adivasi areas in two distinct Jharkhand, 5-6 districts in West Bengal. So, but these were the domains where starvation conditions were there. People and children used to eat, say, jungle shrubs, boil those jungle shrubs. One time only they used to eat some amount of rice, and that too, it's a boiled, what they used to call jungle shrubs, jungli aloo, which is very different from the aloo that we eat. It's not marketed because it's not considered to be, you know, I mean, it's not consumed by other people. So this was the kind of lifestyle. And say children and everyone taking to, you know, forest liquor, etc., of mahua and these things. At the age of say 11, 12, child marriages being rampant at the age of say 12, 13, 14, that kind. So this thing, so in a small rented building, I think 30 minutes are over. So you can also, you know, I mean, just sound me when I'm around 45, 50 minutes. Okay. So, at that time, I first like any good MBA student, you know, we thought that all things can be done by writing a proposal like what we call a B plan, business plan, etc. So people advise you, why don't you make a, you know, B plan for this? You will get all this funding, etc. So I made a proposal, report, etc. And then sought appointments with some executives in various companies. That, to some extent, I could manage because of our IIM network, but it didn't lead me anywhere because nobody wanted to, you know, I mean, bid on something which is not there. I mean, it's just a wishful thinking of one individual. Today he's saying this thing, tomorrow he'll not be there. Maybe he'll take up a job or he'll fail and then leave that. So it was like this. So many of my months, 5-6 more months were lost in this, like I writing emails to corporate people to seek appointments or to send mails or sometimes phone conversation. I was very bad at that because this cold calling I could never do. I can't do it still. So unless I am introduced to someone, I can't even make a conversation. That had been my disability and it still exists. So that's why in my sales and marketing, we had to do a marketing research course at IIM, in which we had to take our questionnaire and travel through the city. So I used to travel throughout the day with still coming with all blank questionnaires. So that was my situation. So I was very bad at that and anyway miserably failed. So all these months were lost, but I thought that I have to do something. So I made some elementary computation. At that time I was thinking of say buying some land because my proposal was also big in nature. It included land, building, all these things. Then say talking of say X number of children in year 1 year 2, all these things. But things don't go as per plans. I mean, most entrepreneurs will tell you that. So it was just that act first, you know, I mean, ready, fire, and you know, aim, as some entrepreneurs put it. Not ready, aim and fire, ready, fire and then aim. Or ready, go and steady, not ready, steady and go. So just act first and then adjust. So it was like in this way, I thought that I'll rent a building. Its rent was 11,000. I sought out, surveyed some rented buildings at that. And then I made some competition that for say 30-40 children, say 6-7 lakh rupees a month, annually will be needed, 7-8 lakh, that kind. Monthly say 50,000. I was planning to start in a very small manner. I thought that for 1 year only 30-40 children. So I thought that if I increase my own delivery of lectures at this for IIM candidates, I can a reasonable amount of money I myself can raise. Of course, I couldn't have given all my time for that because I needed to build this. But still, I increased that, right? From very early morning, then I took some sessions. Or one day out of 3-4 days, I took whole day these sessions. So back-to-back sessions. So this kind of thing. Then some other few friends were there. My mother was my first supporter and owner. So being a very simple lady, my father was more practical. So practical people have more complicated thinking, but my mother being a very simple person, she was almost worshipful of me. So she thought that she went by a very simple premise that whatever, if you're doing good, nothing bad can happen to, that kind of thing. So anyway, like this was the thing. So, and a few friends also, not necessarily from IIM, some from my, you know, earlier association, one or two who had worked with me at Infosys or were at IIT, these kind of things, or were in the school, who had gone to some other college. So anyway, a few people like this. I also then thought. One day this, it stuck me that all the great work in this world has been done by individuals. We unnecessarily think of, you know, collectives. It has, you know, been my firm belief that, you know, collective is a delusionary thing. I mean, a kind of a maya, one could say. In collectives also there is, you know, in successful collectives there is one influential individual who actually like influences others. So the power within an individual will always be an important factor. So I thought, why am I trying with these impersonal entities, people who don't have that decision making capacity, sending to a big corporate, etc. Why not, you know, I mean, write say personally emails to say IIM alumni and instead ask for very, very small sums, token amounts from them. Now it's then up to them whether they want to do. Answer only binary, I mean, yes or no. It won't be, you know, some kind of complicated stretching around, extending the thing. So I, from using IIM's directory, IIM Calcutta's alumni directory, I wrote to some say 1000 plus alumni saying that I am starting this from this day. I had actually like started at that time. I didn't seek any donations before that. I started on, through this, my own lecturing, etc., these things, and through some friend support. The deposit of this rented building was 50,000, which I had some kind small money with me, and the balance one of my friends actually paid. So in this way actually I started. Then out of these alumni, 20, 25, 30 responded to me, which percentage wise was of course small, but I got tremendously encouraged at that time, because I thought that this, when this work is, has not even begun or barely begun, there are people who have never seen me, never visited this, I have never spoken to them physically, they are showing trust in me. So I got tremendous encouragement. So this belief that, you know, I mean, always engaging with individuals, seeing individuals as live people, and, you know, I mean, having some kind of force within them who can be inspired. Individuals can inspire as well as can be inspired, and that makes them live people. Many times impersonal collectives, impersonal entities can never be, you know, I mean, inspired, because they follow their own institutional procedures in such a way that, you know, the capacity to be inspired has been eliminated. So anyway, I always felt comfortable working and engaging with individuals. Now in this way it went on. So some of these people, then after a certain time I began to seek, ask them when I had set up a bank account and all this, I started to invite contributions. Then some of those people visited, they then, you know, I mean, though the efforts are very small in a rented building, but since everything is tangible, at the end of 5 months I had 50 children. I also got encouraged and I was slightly, you know, I mean, aggressive in, you know, you could say, endeavoring, and I thought that support will, because the trend was clear to me that support can flow in, will flow in. So this is like after 6 months I had 50-55 children. Then some new contacts got developed in a bigger league. At the end of 1 year I could take some land, first a 2 acre land. So in this way it started. In my first financial year our collections were 9-10 lakh rupees. That was all we needed at that time. It went to 70 lakhs in the second year itself, because we purchased land, started some construction. From 50, you know, I mean, say first 3 children, then after 15 days around 16 children, after 6 months 55, at the end of 1 year around 69, 70 children. It has come to now 1000 children. This video mentioned 700, so it's a 2.5-3 year old video. So now in this way it started. Similarly, for financial resource wise, from that level now raising around say 10 crore rupees annually, half of which is for OPEX. We are continuously scaling up. So I mean, last year I raised more than 10 crore rupees and 4-5 crores for infrastructure development. So we have now around 20 acres of land, boys camp, residential campus different, girls residential campus different. And in next 3 years, infrastructure development for 2,500 children in next 5 years, that is going on. So it's on an upscale trajectory ever since I started it actually. So, but I wanted to emphasize that it had very, very, you know, I mean, small beginnings and unplanned beginnings. I mean, I wanted to highlight that with unplanned beginnings. So I had thought in the proposal I used to circulate among, say, corporate circles, I used to say that for first 3 years I'll have 40 children, year one, year two, year three, and then I talked of scaling. But I never imagined that within 3 years, without any corporate support, I'll have say 5-7 acres of land and, you know, more than 250 children at the end of 3 years. So this opportunity just came, and it's just making use of those opportunities, always resetting your goals. Also, this one particular idea I want to share, I think I'll exceed my time. So it's just that many things we realize on while we are on the course. Like after a few months, I realized that this gives a tremendous scope of, I mean, my nature of my work being residential institution, I was staying there, I was living 24 hours with the children and other what I called sevavratis. I designed a inspiring sounding name, sevavratis, people vowed to the ideal of service. So not a worker on an employed staff, etc. So sevavratis, everyone was a sevavrati. So I just realized that this residential nature, like an ashram, it gives a tremendous scope of what in sociology is called a total institution. In sociology, there's a concept of total institution, where examples of total institution are, say, it can be a monastery, it can be a convent, it can be a cantonment, military cantonment, any kind of thing where, you know, I mean, the difference between personal life and the work you live, community life or the work life, is diminished to a very, very significant extent. So this has its own, you know, I mean, advantages. Of course, I always has had a model before me of the Ramakrishna order and its institutions, and observing other total institutions also, say some practices, say from maybe the culture in an army cantonment, set whatever. What I'm saying is that it opened up new frontiers of imagination before me, which I never realized when I was starting. So what I want to emphasize on, new dimensions come. I then designed my most importantly, my HR on those lines, began to engage with such people, took people who will be very dedicated and work for whole of their life, even if they are from very humble backgrounds or maybe having very so-called very ordinary, say, educational qualification, etc. But in various roles, I always looked at a person, looked at the individual. So I did what was opposite of recruitment. In recruitment, when we talk of recruitment in a corporate manner, it goes by this, that you have a role in your mind and then you look for a person who fits that role. What I was doing was just opposite of recruitment. When I became interested in that person, I took him or her, and then I thought what role he can play, what space he can create for himself or herself. So in this, when people evolve, people are groomed, people develop. I didn't mind a person, you know, evolving over a few years, because I was looking for spans of maybe next 25, 30 years or more. When I am taking, say, a 25-year-old or 20, some cases even younger people, they can work for maybe 3 decades or more actively with me. So that was my idea. On those lines, I actually continued. Now, here, like, one particular thing I also want to share, talking of, you know, motivation. This, I think that motivation is generally of, you know, it has two dimensions to it. One, I like to call it, is the ambition dimension, or another name we can give it is a milestone dimension, where you are motivated by certain milestones before you. For example, if somebody is running a company, then suppose it is of 10 crore rupees turnover, having a milestone of making it 50 crores or 100 or 500. These are milestones over a certain timeline, which would inspire us, motivate us. This is an important dimension, definitely. But there is a much deeper dimension, which I like to call the anchor dimension, or a substitute word could be a mission dimension, which is independent of the milestones. Because like milestones in the ambition dimension, you were driven or motivated by milestones which you have before you. It's very important, the milestone dimension, because it helps in planning. When you have already started your work, you need to plan also, setting goals, etc., within a certain time frame. But this mission dimension or anchoring dimension is independent of this. It just means that it's your second nature. It's your, why second nature? It's your first nature, essential nature, which you are manifesting. So it's your swabhav. I mean, talking in terms of, you know, the Gita, it's a swabhav then. You are just simply manifesting your swabhav. You can't live without it, basically. So, I think all entrepreneurs, particularly in the social sphere, because in social sphere we deal with lots of human lives and our actions have a tremendous impact on other lives around us. It comes with tremendous responsibility, therefore. So, one can't just, like in an adventuristic streak, you know, start a venture or close it down one fine day when one is bored or fatigued, etc. It comes with a tremendous responsibility. So, this anchoring dimension actually like ensures this. If you have this feeling that this is what my life is for, this is what my life is for. Because I asked myself when I was starting this, I thought that, say, suppose after 10 years, I have to live with, say, 20 children only, because my work suppose remains at that level, and I have to keep on, say, taking lectures for IIM entrance exams, and in this way only carrying my life. Will I be fine with it? That was a question before myself. And when within myself I got a, you know, yes as the answer, then only I became sure that, yeah, this is independent of the milestones. It's not that certain milestones which are, you know, driving me. Milestones are useful. They help in planning, sometimes in on a day-to-day basis also motivate us, motivate others in our team, our colleagues, etc. But within ourselves, we need a much deeper stratum, a much deeper level dimension of motivation, which is the anchoring dimension. I think it's essentially a spiritual quality. The anchoring dimension of motivation is essentially a spiritual quality, as against the milestone dimension, which is more cerebral in nature. So this is one thing which I wanted to share with you, because during nascent stages of any entrepreneurial initiative and during crisis times can come at any point of time later on in the lifetime of an organization. So during both these times, it's the anchoring dimension which will keep on energizing you. It won't be the milestone dimension, because when you are in crisis, your company is sinking or your social initiative or anything that is collapsing in a very difficult condition, you won't think of, you know, I mean, these milestones won't inspire you at that. You are totally unclear of how the future will be. It's like being in the midst of an ocean and, you know, I mean, hanging on to muscle log of wood in the middle of an ocean. It's like this. You won't know where you will reach, but that is your swabhav to hang on to it. It's you are anchored to it. It's essentially a spiritual quality. Now this thing I wanted to share. This actually, once I was just thinking a few minutes before this, while sitting on the dais, this one idea struck me, which I want to share with you. It was from my Gurudev Swami Ranganathananji, from whom I got my Diksha. So he always used to say about service or attitude of service, seva bhav. He said in very simple terms, service is this line: what can I do for you? This simple line, if it is there in the backs of our mind, in all or any interpersonal transactions, it could be with anyone. When we talk of service, why do you think only of, say, privileged ones serving, say, you know, underprivileged? It can be between equals, or it can be serving even a more privileged person than you. Service is of different kinds at, you know, different occasions. So even sometimes, say, smiling at a person, thing like this, we doesn't need any resources, or with great sincerity asking about one's well-being, or expressing your real genuine, you know, empathy at a particular feeling which someone else has. All these are also acts of service. They don't need any resources, and they are actually like it's a 24-hour thing. And it brings me to one of my favorite lines, one utterance of Swami Ranganathananji, that there is no holiday in spiritual life. This was one of his lines. There is no holiday in spiritual life. It's a 24-hour-7 thing. You know, it was long before these call centers and BPOs had come. Spiritual life was a 24-hour-7 occupation, 24-hour-7 vocation. So it was this attitude of service, having just this, what can I do for you, in your mind, at all, in all interactions with whosoever. I think this is true service. We don't need to start an organization. We don't need to start a social enterprise, an NGO, or figure out a social domain, say of destitute children or ailing women or whatever. If you do that, if it's your calling, it's fine. But even in regular life, one can always manifest this seva bhav. This is very important. And you know, Ranganathananji spoke of this three levels of force or power or strength in any being, and in human being particularly. He said, he mentioned bahubal, then buddhibal as the first two. Bahubal meaning, you know, muscular physical power. Buddhibal, the cerebral mind power. And the third one, atmabal, or the yogbal, basically. Which is very, very interesting. To illustrate this, like, everyone knows what bahubal, even animals, bees, or say dinosaurs or elephants or whale, it can have a huge bahubal, physical power, raw physical power. Buddhibal, human beings had buddhibal, that's why they captured and came to the top of the kingdom of living beings and could control other beings. But you know, Ranganathanji mentioned one particular idea. This I want to share with you, as you know, before we start taking questions. He mentioned about Sir Julian Huxley being one of the most eminent biologists of the 20th century. So Julian Huxley actually said that now what the certain force which will now be needed and which will determine the direction of civilization and of human beings in times to come will not be the bahubal or the buddhibal. The explanation he gave for this was that through buddhibal, human being has first of all created those things which can be substituted for, say, bahubal. For example, you know, we can't have wings like birds, but we have actually created, say, aeroplanes which are a substitute for that, or more efficient substitute for that. But you can like imagine, and so many examples will be there. So basically he said that this physical evolution, what Julian Huxley said, was that physical evolution is no more required. It's a very, very powerful revolutionary idea, that physical evolution is no more required, because through buddhibal, human beings can create external organs. They don't need to develop those organs within yourself. You don't need to, you know, evolve for millions of years to have wings, because you have created an aeroplane. To swim, you don't need to create the organs which a fish uses to swim, because you have made a ship, and which is an external organ. So organs don't need to be biologically developed within the physical organism, but through bahubal, external organs. So all machines, all tools, therefore, are external organs which are substitutes of some kind of a bahubal using the buddhibal. Now, this Ranganathananji posed this question, that in certain question, is buddhibal the highest form of bal? This is a very challenging question, because generally we think it is so. Our education system also mainly highlight this, that bahubal, human beings are superior because of buddhibal, cerebral power, mind power, brain, because of brain we rule. But he just pose certain situation. For example, a very basic situation, to a, say, government employee, ordinary government employee, if somebody is, say, offering a bribe of X rupees, 10,000 rupees for tasks to be done, how will he respond? if he says no, suppose if he says no, I won't take, from where, what force is actually like helping him to take this decision? Suddenly it's not related to Bahubal in any way. Is it related to Buddhi Bal? Maybe the Buddhi will say that if you take this 10,000 and if you work out that you will not get caught, then it's a better, good decision, because then, you know, I mean, you can buy all this or you can do these things for your family. So if he says no, from where, from what level is it coming? So Ranganathananji used to say that in such situations, it doesn't come from the Bahubal, doesn't come from the Buddhi Bal, it comes from third level, which is the Atma Bal. And this is what, you know, the moral authority, the spiritual quality, spiritual power, power of purity, power of selflessness, which Maharaj mentioned and which Swamiji always, you know, emphasized. That was the central theme of Swamiji, essential divinity within all human beings. This X factor, this is why I called it an X factor in the beginning of my talk, because you can't, it can't be articulated in by an intellectual construct. There is no intellectual construct which explains it. So this Atma Bal, this inspires us. Similarly, in any kind of situations or temptation, if we are able to win it out, win in that situation, it's not because of Buddhi Bal. Buddhi Bal will not help us. All through our academics, even in institutions like IITs, or it can be MIT or Harvard, anywhere, emphasis is on the Buddhi Bal, how to refine it, fine tune it, but not on, you know, how to develop the Atma Bal, how in fact to refine your own emotions, because these emotions are very closely related to the Atma Bal. That will be a digression, but a tangential reference I want to make here, because Swamiji always said that emotional training is required. We don't have enough emotional training. He used to say all our education is about intellectual training, you know, refining and training our emotions, our feelings, because at the end of the day, heart is the seat of all power. It's Swamiji's line, not mine. Knowledge and wisdom are mere superfluities, the surface glitter merely. It's the heart which is the seat of all power. This is his line. So to wrap it up, my, you know, I mean, before we take any questions, I think like such a kind of a force in some way we should try to develop within ourselves. And it, the beauty of this is that it passes on. It's very, very tangible. It passes on, it has its effect. It's sure to have its effect. It's a law. It's sure to have its effect on others. That is how inspirational, you know, people operate. They know, they are sometimes very conscious of that force within themselves also. And it rubs off. It's bound to rub off, rub on to other people. So, and this, with this only we'll have the seva bhav attitude of what can I do for you. This attitude which every moment we can carry and we should carry, because as Ranganathanji mentions, so spiritual life is a 24 into 7 vocation. There is no holiday in spiritual life. So with these words I want to end my, you know, this talk before we take the questions. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for sharing such an inspiring experience. Now the floor is open for questions. If anyone has any question, raise your hands. Our volunteers will pass the mic.
Yeah. My name is Narayan Pai. I'm from Mechanical Department. I want to ask is IIM experience is really required to do the work what you have done in your field? Or I mean, or is it fine like if you have started from your after IIT also?
Look, as I said that I didn't plan these things, you know, it wasn't a rational decision. I mean, many things have been irrational in what I have done. People ask me that I started in Bengal at that time when I had to learn that language. I could have started in a more familiar area. All these ifs and buts are there. But in hindsight, I mean, I believe that, you know, I mean, there is a right time for, right time when things happened, there is a certain, you know, I being, you know, I mean, a follower of Swami Vivekananda, I believe that certain forces also guide you. So there is a right time, I mean, for when things happen. I I didn't plan at that time. I was possibly not ready for it. That's why such thoughts never came into my mind when I was out of my IIT. Maybe I would have miserably failed had I attempted any such thing at that point of time. So things happen, I mean, in their own way. So about this, but I think, I mean, your question is also about this thing, whether my degree or skills that I acquired, whether they really helped. Now it's difficult to say, I mean, I can't quantify the manner in which they helped. Any kind of intellectual equipment also helps us. But it's not that I gained intellectual equipment at IIM, because I hardly attended classes, etc. In fact, whatever intellectual growth I may have had has happened after that, because of my reading on my own, I mean, about things or the own whatever scholarly pursuits I have tried to do in my own way during all these years. So education doesn't end, you know. So, but definitely these two, IIT and IIM, being well known, you know, brands in our country, they helped. This particular association with these two brands, being an alumnus of these two institutions, this definitely helped me. And the network, who you have, that thing, you know, that coming from, particularly from IIM, because it had small close-knit networks, unlike the IITs. The IIM networks in my initial years were very helpful. But had I not been in IIM, even then maybe I would have, like, in some way, so many people do, I mean, even much greater things, they are not IIT or IIM alumni, so doesn't matter. But whatever, yeah, I mean, these skills in some way are helpful, network is helpful.
Apart from IIT, I mean, only IIM also is the point I'm saying. Like, if I'm...
That also, look, because of IIM I came to Calcutta. Had I not come joined IIM, maybe this wouldn't have started, because I started this in Calcutta. So I, in some way, you know, that resonance in my mind or certain inspiration or meeting some people, all that happened there, it was meant to be there, possibly. I mean, in hindsight, this is what I can say, because there is no rational explanation for this. So, I mean, I can't say that, I mean, as I said that, even without it, maybe, like, it would have got secured, but it's a hypothetical thing, so I can't really say.
I congratulate for your good work.
Thank you.
And I want to know that how such an organization sustains.
Right.
Like you told us how it was built upon.
Right.
But, how do you continue to sustain it for such long time?
Correct.
And if somebody is looking into such a venture, so is it dependent on, is it a self-dependent thing, or it entirely depends on help from others?
Right. I'll address all these, you know, points that you had. One thing is this, that my basic feeling about, say, sustainability, about success, all these things stems from or springs from this particular line which Swami Vivekananda says. It's one of my favorite lines. It goes like this: manifest your divinity and everything will be harmoniously arranged around you. So it's just that if you, as I said, I always thought, and I took it as a spiritual law, that if I try to become more and more pure, unselfish, which is the motto of this forum, so trying to be, I mean, selfless, purposeful, devoted, and trying to give this feeling to all my co-workers, ensuring that they also manifest this to whatever extent possible, then I was always confident that things will fall into place as they have. So I never worried about these things. Now coming to sustainability, look, sustainability, there is a whole lot of corporate thinking around this thing. That today only I was discussing with one Maharaj at one of our mission centers about this thing. I think that there is a whole lot of, you know, corporate talk about organizations generating revenues, social enterprises or social organizations generating revenues for themselves, in order to, as you said, become self-dependent, etc. But you know, I mean, it's a complex question basically. I would like to break this complexity before you, I mean, so that you can analyze it for yourself in a more clearer way. One thing is that this is an age of specialization.
Now, in an age of specialization, what does an age of specialization mean? It means that everyone should do what one is good at. This is the basic assumption and basic premise on which an age of specialization is built. So, that is why, like, if an NGO is, say, its domain is of, say, caretaking of, say, children, developing them or educating, or, say, healthcare, rural healthcare or certain livelihood, then it is best, it's for the social, you know, optimal good that they should concentrate their best energies on that particular thing and should not, you know, deviate their energies into other things, say, to run a side business, to generate revenue for that, etc. Similarly, corporates, if an IT solutions company is there, it should best concentrate its energies on that. I once met CEO of a very, very big, I mean, one of the top 3-4 IT companies in India. So, there, like, he also talked about this sustainability thing, and he was of the opinion, I mean, similar opinion, which I feel is very, very current in, you know, has a great currency in the corporate echelons. It is this that NGO should become, you know, start generating revenues in some. So I said that, you know, I mean, we should look at sustainability as a system, systemic sustainability. It shouldn't be that individual standalone entities should be expected to do everything. In an age of specialization, as a system, we need to be sustainable. A corporate is very good at, you know, I mean, its business, it has its aim and objectives as to maximize the profits for the shareholders, etc. It's one of the key aims which drives a corporate. It's best at doing that. Let them do that. And as a system, we should be sustainable. So, in essence, I told that CEO, I said that you earn money, I'll spend that money. Because the age of specialization means this. The social enterprises, why make businessmen out of social enterprise? You know, everyone has to go by their swabhav. You know, it's not in my swabhav to run a business enterprise merely to generate revenues. And it's a division of best energy, say, of me and people who are working with. So this is a key thing. So I have a very serious, you know, difference in opinion about this particular thing. And in fact, good thing is that the whole we are moving toward this only. What I thought, I always thought, because the new Companies Act, which has a CSR provision of all companies, you know, giving 2% of their net profits to the social sector, actually is pointing and going toward that only as a systemic sustainability, rather than, say, NGOs, you know, doing their own business to be sustainable. Also, second thing is that then there will be huge scaling bars on social enterprises. We can do that, but it will, since a lot of our energy will go into that, it will put a huge scaling bar. We won't be able to scale as fast as we can. And desirable that social enterprise scale fast in a country like India, where need in various domains is huge. This is also one, you know, counter logic to this. Third is that if you are generating revenue, you are then a participant in the market. So market doesn't, then you have to play by the rules of the market, and market will not see that you are, you know, so your profits or revenues go into the social cost. They'll judge you by that, rules of the market. And in markets, lots of companies fail. How many small companies how many ventures actually begin to survive? Those which survive, how many of them reach from small scale to middle scale? How many of middle scale become large scale? Of hundreds and thousands of IT companies, there is one Infosys, one Wipro, isn't it? So, then the market will dictate you. So, chances of you becoming a, you know, major player in your social domain itself will be very, very minimal. And the last thing, which is also a very essential thing, is that there is a need to give in people, which will always remain. Swami Vivekananda said that spirituality is the constitutional need of human mind. This is one line. And I feel this, you know, giving, sharing is one of the, you know, essential things, essential requirements, seeking this oneness through giving. So philanthropy is a constitutional need. It will remain a constitutional need. This, even like I have interacted with some big magnitude, you know, high net worth donors. I have talked to them about this sustainability. One of them actually laughed before me and said, that if all NGOs become self-sustaining, what shall people like us do? It's our need to give. Where shall we go? So there is a spiritual need. That's also spiritual need to give. That will always remain. And for a section of society, it will always remain. So all these things point out toward this, that we should try to do our work in the, you know, best possible, purest form of me. My guiding line has been this: manifest your divinity, everything else will harmoniously arranged around you. So I have not tried to, you know, be too complex in my thought about this. I have tried to maintain this simple thinking. Things have worked out for me. Yeah.
Good evening, sir. Thank you very much for that inspirational
thank
talk.
Thank you.
Just I would like to know, like, what kind of support you are getting from the government, either from the state level or at center level, at least after the government started
right.
recognizing your good work.
Look, my expectation from the government wasn't that it should help this work through, say, resources, etc. Because the government resources, government help often comes with a lot of loss in autonomy, which also I didn't want. So that wasn't the thing. In fact, I always expected that they'll probably offer me a bigger canvas to contribute, say through other social enterprises which the government supports, say in West Bengal or in the country. But in that regard, I think I am not much satisfied. In West Bengal, there is a lot of politicization. It's a very, very highly politicized state, and by politics we don't mean government or the class of politicians. Politics is in common people. In villages of Bengal, I always use this line: each voter is a politician in Bengal. So any issue becomes a political issue. So these things, government could have insured us in fact from all these kind of political tussles, turbulences, small kind of niggles, I would say, if not big turbulences, niggles which keep on coming. So that hasn't happened the way it could have happened through greater support and also a bigger canvas to contribute. Say all shelter homes or children welfare institution in West Bengal, if they involve us to upgrade them, and through our intervention we can really upgrade. So these kind of things, but no such opportunity is there. So but a few opportunities have come. Like I have been on Government of India's, you know, task force in Ministry of Women and Child. Similarly, I am in a national committee in Ministry of Finance, which gives the 100% tax exemption status under Section 35AC. It's a very, very privileged, you know, this thing, provision. Only a very few NGOs for very specific projects get a 100% tax exemption. So I am on the committee which selects which NGO should be given that. It's headed by the Chief Justice of India and it's a 12-member committee. So I'm on that. So these things give opportunity for a macro contribution also. But yeah, I mean, in that sense, I think I wasn't looking from a very narrow financial support from government. That till this point I didn't want. I've never been dogmatic of my thinking, so I can't comment on future. But till this point I didn't need that. But things which I expected and maybe which they could have offered, like a bigger canvas, these kind of engagement or insuring us against disturbances, these like haven't been served, fulfilled.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
This will be last but one question.
Yeah.
So you mentioned about how working with motive and working with emotion and how Parivaar is different from other organizations, the anchoring part. So I would like to know, see, because you've seen so many organizations, how do they face these kind of situations without these kind of policies or
strength? Actually, I once read a line which I remembered. It is that all great institutions are shadow of some great man. So basically, that leadership is very, very important. And leadership by, as I said, character, force, personal example, moral authority. You know, take the best surviving sustainable institution of our modern times. It is the Ramakrishna modern mission. It's the finest example of sustainability. You were talking of sustainability, of succession, institutionalization of, say, succession, institutionalization of sustainability. So
how has that survived over so many generations? So many generations. It is that it had some very, very core fundamentals which drove this great institution. Those fundamentals were so strong that it has automatically been sustainable. Now many organizations, you know, sometimes even the founder or key people who started that, even they are insincere. So no hope for such organizations. But even where founders are sincere, mate, and they fail to institutionalize this thing within others. And it calls for a sense of detachment, great detachment actually. Because they need to understand that at the end of the day, they will be leaving all this. You know, they have to leave this world, and institution also they have to leave. So better prepare others and, you know, institutionalize things for that. As Swamiji said, when he said that, you know, confided that, you know, he will be leaving his body, and he said that if a great tree is there, then under its shadows, other smaller trees can't grow, can't develop. So many times founder leaders become very attached to their creations. So I think institutionalization of sustainability, of succession, continuity, this calls for a great detachment. I think we don't need to look beyond the Ramakrishna mission, I mean, in this regard. Yeah.
We'll take last two questions.
I don't have a question, but I thought, you know, as a senior person, I really liked that you had a dream, you followed it, and you realized it.
Yeah,
that is to be applauded.
Yeah, thank you.
And the way you answered all the young men's questions, you know, as though it was a very simple journey, you know, made me remember a couple of lines of Robert Frost, which I'll read out.
Right.
I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
Thank you.
It's a nice journey, nice starting point, and a wonderful journey you are actually have taken up. I just wanted to know what is this learning that the children do there? Daily events?
It's an overall educational, overall development institution. So children right from a very young age, from the age of say 4 or 5, and towards till higher education, college graduation, it could be post graduation. So end to end basically, right from when they are very young to the highest possibilities. Possibilities may differ between say one child and another, but the whole emphasis is on the higher possibilities being manifested. So it's like our earlier set of children are now well past, I mean, the colleges they are in, they are getting into good jobs. Some are also, you know, have interned with us and joined Parivaar itself in some capacities. So it's like this, and we have our own in-campus school which is affiliated to the West Bengal board, regular formal school. And after that, you know, I mean, depending on the streams they take, our boys have been in computer science, engineering, through say clearing the state say joint entrance exam for engineering, or in say nursing or commerce accountancy, interning under some chartered accountants, all these things, getting workplace experience, or in different kind of streams. So it's an end-to-end education and overall development thing.
How do you pick the children?
Yeah.
From where?
We get thousands of cases each year. We have our own field network across around 15 different districts, around 10-11 in West Bengal, 2 in Jharkhand, and some other areas in Bihar. Now, and lots of other cases come to us through say on their own also through certain field groups, some other smaller NGOs, through these references. Then we have a site inquiry procedure which assesses the neediness level, criticality of need to be admitted into a long-term residential program, a free long-term residential program. Our institution is West Bengal's largest free residential institution right now. So it's like, and also takes into consideration, since there's a lot of pre-admission engagement with say whosoever the relative, many times no parents are there, so other relative, it could be an old grandmother who's in the last leg of her life, or sometimes a small NGO which is referring. So this engagement, that ensuring that there will be a, it's not taken to be a stopgap arrangement, that the child will drop out say after a couple of years or something, or if a girl is there, then at the age of 13, 14 she will be plucked out to be married. So it is made clear, and you know, it needs a continuous engagement, obviously, that everyone, the referring people, guardians, relatives of the child, in fact the entire villages from where they come, they are in sync with what journey the child is going through at Parivaar. And there is give a statistic. There has been less than 2% of discontinuity dropout. Out of say 1,000 children, less than 15-16 who were at any point of time admitted into Parivaar have, you know, dropped out. So there is a tremendous, you know, more than 98% continuity into say higher education, that kind. In all our grade 10 batches, high school, which is the common, I mean, state board examination, all batches have had a 100% pass result, which is like, comparing it to say government, say ashram shalas in those tribal areas or these kind, they'll have around 20-25% pass result. And that is with a huge dropout before that also. Like, out of everyone who was enrolled for class 1 in a, say, government institution in a tribal area, only maybe 25% managed to reach class 10. And out of those who appear, again 25% managed to pass. So taking these together, it's a 6-7% actually of the entire set who were enrolled, who started the school, only 6-7% actually pass. Whereas in our case, there is no dropout, and all 100% managed to clear class 10, class 12, in fact getting into higher education. So yeah, it's like this.
Yeah, lots of questions are there, but I think I will stop here.
Yeah, but for the domain, for this, you were asking domain questions. So for that, our website is also there. You can see our website. I have around 10 booklets here. So maybe some of you can take them. Students may possibly share among themselves, and others can take one copy each. So I think we have around a dozen copies. So I request Bharadwaj to, you know, later on distribute them. So reading this also, you will get an idea. And you have our website, etc., which have a lot of information resources.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, and thank you. It was a great pleasure and privilege and honor to be before all of you. And I, you know, thank all of you, the students, the faculty who had come here, and most of all our very revered, you know, Swamiji's of our beloved order, who, I mean, in my own life, I would have been nothing without, say, the influence of the Ramakrishna movement. So I can't, you know, overemphasize the influence of the Ramakrishna movement on me. So I thank all of you. Thank you.
Now I request Professor Shivakumar, Dean of Students, to present a memento to Sri Vinayak Lohani. Now I request our Dean of Students to speak few words.
Just a couple of words. I'm in awe, inspiring. I have no other words to say anything about the kind of work that he has done. Can I offer to support at least one kid of your Parivaar? Thank you.
Now I request Professor Balaji sir to present the books to Sri Vinayak Lohani ji. Feedback forms are being distributed by our volunteers. Please fill them. If anyone is interested in joining us, please tick the appropriate mark. Now we shall have a skit presented by Samskrita Bharati volunteers.
I offer my pranams unto the feet of all the Swamijis. My namaskara to all. Every year, Vivekananda Study Circle is organizing Sanskrit classes. This year also, they are planning to organize the classes during September 20th and 21st, Saturday and Sunday, and 27th and 28th, Saturday and Sunday, only four classes. If you attend four classes, definitely you can speak in Sanskrit. Every year we are conducting in the IIT campus, many students are able to speak fluently in Sanskrit. It is very easy to speak in this language. To show that there is a small conversation between two persons, one is a doctor and another is a patient, how they are conversing in Sanskrit.
उदरवेदनास्ति
किम कष्टम किम कष्टम
उदरवेदना
उदरवेदना वा किम कादितवान किम कादितवान एकम फलम मात्रम कादितवान उदरवेदना वा
एकम मात्रम कादितवान
किम फलम कादितवान
एकम फनस फलम कादितवान जैकफ्रूट कादितवान
फनस फलम कादितवान तदेव कारणम अस्तु औषधं ददामि एतत् खादतु
एतत् खादामि उदरवेदना आगच्छति
गच्छति
उत्तमम्
अस्तु आगच्छतु
एतत् खादामि उदरवेदना आगच्छति पत्रं खादामि उदरवेदना
खादितवान् औषधं खादितवान्
औषधं वा
आम्
भवान् एकं पत्रं दत्तवान् एतत् खादतु उदरवेदना आगच्छति
पत्रं नास्ति औषधम् औषधं पुनः लिखामि
ददातु
औषधं खादतु मेडिकल्स् गच्छतु औषधं स्वीकरोतु खादतु
पत्रं नास्ति
पत्रं नास्ति भद्रं भवतु
अस्तु वैद्य वैद्य
किमर्थम् एवं
स्ट्रेट् मम उदरवेदना नास्ति
उदरवेदना नास्ति
नास्ति
उत्तमं किमर्थम् एवम् आगच्छति
किन्तु एवमेव आगच्छामि कारणं किं
सैड् मध्ये आगच्छति औषधं खादितवान् किल
सम्यक् खादितवान्
सैड् एफेक्ट् अस्ति
ओ धन्यवादः इन् दि सांस्कृतिक क्लासेस् यु केन् सी वेरियस् स्माल् गेम्स् अण्ड् आल् दि नाटकास् So easily you can pick up the language. So kindly register your name for the Sanskrit class. Dhanyavada.
Now I request our coordinator Bharadwaji to deliver a vote of thanks.
Namaste. I thank Shri Vinayak Lohani ji for his inspiring speech and clearing the questions. Then I thank Shri N.S. Narayan Swami sir for immediately accepting our invitation and delivering address. And then I thank our mentor for the past 10 years for his support and guidance, Swami Atmashuddhananji Maharaj. Then I thank the director IIT Madras, Dean of Students, for their support. I thank CC for supporting us in recording this event. I thank Dean ICSR for the auditorium. I thank Transport Section IIT Madras, Taramani Guest House authorities and staff, Security Section IIT Madras, and I thank Professor C. Balaji sir for his guidance. I thank Swamijis and Brahmacharis from Ramakrishna Math for graciously attending our inaugural. Lastly, I thank all the previous and present volunteers of VSC for helping me out, and most importantly, I thank all the audience for their patience, time, and presence. Thank you.
I have few announcements to make. You can visit us at our YouTube channel, VSC IIT Madras. And we are proud to present that our YouTube channel has more than 1 lakh views. And before leaving, please collect the calendars and coordination books outside the auditorium. And we are also conducting a book sale and photograph exhibition on life and teachings of Swami Vivekananda at HSB 133. And Sanskrit Bharati registrations are also taking place there. Interested people can register there. So we shall end this glorious evening with a Shanti Mantra recital by our volunteers.
Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina Sarve Santu Niramayah Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत् ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ तत्सत् जयन्त्।